Coming up on Nebraska Stories, Lincoln's Telephone Museum takes its last call. On the road with Figaro. The most loved and hated ref in college basketball. And using a pen to heal the wounds of war.
Two ringy dingies.
Hello?
Phone home.
From iconic scenes in television and movies to everyday life, the telephone has played an important role in our lives since its invention in 1876.
Mr. Watson, come here. I want you.
The first phones arrived in Omaha in 1877, with Lincoln following the next year. And today, it's in Lincoln where you could visit one of the best telephony collections in the United States, if you knew where to look.
We're the best kept secret in town. You know, the folks that we can get in here really think it's worthwhile. They didn't know it's here. Many say they've driven by here so many times.
Located on the edge of downtown Lincoln, the Frank H. Woods Telephone Museum opened in the early 90s and was staffed by volunteers, all former telephone employees. The collection spans from the time of the telephone's invention to present day.
I think we're one of the top 10 in the nation. I always promote this 1890 payphone over here as being very unique because it's the way you collect the money is no different than you do it today. The stowage of dials that are 11-hole dials, where the top one is your operator, is kind of unique. The man that developed the dial phone devised the system that we use today, and this took the operator out of it. You dial your own call, you control your own destiny when you're dialing people. So they started developing one of these.
But at its heart, the museum is an homage to the 100-year history of the Lincoln Telephone and Telegraph Company and its founder, Frank H. Woods.
In the little towns around here, they had what were called a switchboard.
Bob Culver worked at Lincoln Telephone while Frank Woods was still at the helm.
A very professional businessman. That on the business side, he was very good at what he did, and on the other side, he was very comfortable with having people be a family type of thing.
By the time Frank Woods went into the phone business in 1904, the American Bell Telephone Company was already an industry giant, and mainly in cities. Today, we know them as AT&T. Independent phone companies like Lincoln Telephone provided service to rural communities. In 1910, Frank Woods was elected president of the National Independent Telephone Association and immediately found himself in a high-stakes negotiation with Bell Telephone.
At that time, he went to AT&T to talk about them, and originally they visited about it, and Frank got real disgusted, got up, walked out.
Already a powerful monopoly, Bell Telephone was under threat of an antitrust lawsuit by President Woodrow Wilson. Bell executives found themselves at the negotiating table with a young Nebraskan. At stake was access to Bell's long-distance lines and for Bell to stop buying its competitors. Tempers flared. Finally, when an exasperated Woods abruptly walked out, Bell executives chased after him. A deal was struck. Called the Kingsbury Commitment, it gave birth to our modern phone system. The president of Bell Telephone called Woods the great independent, and living up to his name, Woods went on to build the third largest independent telephone company of his time.
We did a lot of firsts, Lincoln Telephone did. The first dial system was in Lincoln in 1904. First mobile radio was 1946. First 911 system was in 68 in Hebron. They were pioneers in a lot of things.
But now it has come to an end. The museum lost its home and the collection was put up for sale.
Our hope from the very beginning was that it would remain local. We have no control over it.
Lincoln Telephone was sold to Altel 20 years ago, but the museum sits on property that's being redeveloped, and the volunteers had no luck finding a new home.
We have looked at a lot of buildings. We have no money. Our membership is old.
The volunteers found they had no other choice but to close the museum. They put the collection up for sale as a single lot and have earmarked the proceeds to be invested in a college scholarship fund.
Oh, I hate to see it go. It was also about the people and the folks I worked with, you know, that you were dedicated. I started out, did my job, and was very lucky. We had a real loyalty and made some really, really good friends.
Awesome. Honestly, I feel like it just goes right out. It's so easy to sing in here. Holy cow.
Susanna, I hope Basilio has passed on my messages to you.
I'm flattered, but...
I realized how insensitive I was being.
As performing artists, we're always striving to make our work ever new. But when you have a tour like this, you don't need much prodding because it really is. And, you know, the acoustics are different, the ambiance is different, the where you are in relationship to the audience, it all just makes it feel like you're creating this thing on the spot.
Yeah, keep coming.
Oh,
we might as well just
pull into one theater, see where the doors are. See where the exits and entrances are going to be, where are we going to put the orchestra, and on your mark, get set, go.
I don't think I'm helping.
Okay, somebody take over on this.
What I've long wanted to do is take opera out to rural Nebraska.
Stage right, stage left.
And so Marriage of Figaro, you know, it's arguably the greatest. It's just the best opera that there ever was. And it seemed like the right choice to do. Shortly after we announced the project, I got a call from who is now my dear friend, Pam Promodka from Friend, Nebraska. She said, you've got to come to Friend. Oh my gosh, was that a great decision. I had a couple colleagues of mine say, you must check out Ord, Nebraska. You must see what's going on in Ord. I had no idea they had the vibrant sort of performing arts community that they have. What each one of these communities has in common is a group of people that are so passionate about bringing the arts to their towns, to their cities. Norfolk had a different kind of vibe about it. We performed in a very modern theater at the community college. But I think it's important because in some ways that represents who is taking responsibility these days for the arts.
So Jared, go ahead and take your...
It's educational institutions that have taken more and more of a partnership in cultural presentations. The first decision I made was to go to Red Cloud. Red Cloud has a long tradition of having theatrical events. A perfect example of an opera house that was vibrant in the 1880s, the 1890s, in Willa Cather's lifetime, and her spirit is there. Nothing takes hold of a child like living people, and what she was talking about was live theater. You have to rethink how you're going to get audiences. I think if we really believe in this, we have to go out to our audiences and actually find them. And then, of course, it was a really special day when we did the public performance there. We did the first act up in the old space, which was just remarkable.
I'm Bill Shomas. I'm the director of the opera program at UNL, and I want to welcome everyone here this afternoon. Isn't this wonderful? Isn't this just wonderful? You think back what this would have been like 100 years ago, despite being an opera house. All we can tell, this is the first time that any opera has actually been performed in here. And so that's a great honor for us as well. So with no further ado, I'm going to introduce our conductor this afternoon, my good colleague, Jeff McCrae, and he'll get things going. Act one of The Marriage of Figaro.
Expecting the turnout that we had. And I know how accommodating and how hospitable small town folk can be, but the response that we got for this tour just completely blew me away. It definitely got to me in a place that I wasn't expecting at all. And, you know, they were so responsive, they were laughing, which gives us even more energy as we're going along.
Have a great day.
I loved what happened in Ord, because here you have a small community, and we filled their theater, and these were people from Ord coming to see opera in a place where opera had never been performed before.
It's game night for the Nebraska Huskers, and in the middle of this big-time college basketball atmosphere filled with players...
Hey, whistle blow, stop, my man! Hey, hey!
Coaches...
Your guy's going like this, this guy's going like this. It's the difference.
And fans, is a man dressed in black and white, making split-second decisions that aren't always black and white. Referee John Higgins is always in the middle of the action, but his goal is to be invisible.
He knows he's wrong.
To me, that's the highest compliment you could say about the refereeing. So if we stayed out of the way and let the kids play and do it and let them play legally, and they're not talking about me, amen, thank you. That means you've done a good job. You don't want to be the highlight of the ESPN missing the call and everybody knowing your name, but that's your goal, is to be invisible.
Higgins, who grew up in Omaha and still lives there, has made a name for himself in college basketball. He's among the sport's top referees, having officiated 7 Final Fours and 2 NCAA championship games. It's a far cry from how he got started back in college, jumping at the chance to earn $25 to fill in when the referees for a freshman game didn't show up. Basketball has always been a constant companion for Higgins.
Thanks, big fella.
Through grade school, through high school, through college, I've been in basketball, involved in it probably every day of my life and talked about it every day of my life.
That's partly because of his dad, Roger, who coached basketball and just about every other sport at Omaha's Cathedral High School. His dad was a fiery competitor, and as a coach, not afraid to give his young son, the referee, feedback on his work.
I took him 2, 3, 4 games, and he critiqued me most of all the plays that I missed. I said, "How about all the plays I got right?" And but he was good about it though. In the long run, he was really proud.
John needed the drive his dad passed on to him to make it as a referee. He started with rec league and elementary school games, then eventually got noticed at a referee camp and started to work some college games. Refereeing, though, isn't his full-time job. More than 3 decades ago, he started a roofing company that he still owns and operates today. It's named, appropriately enough, Rooferees. When you're traveling thousands of miles across the country 6 months out of the year, refereeing 90-some games, it can make it difficult to run a business, but he gets it done.
Nowadays, when you have a computer and a cell phone, you don't have to be at your office all day long.
That travel schedule also means Higgins spends many days during the season apart from his family.
It's hard on my family and myself being away. I like to be home, because when I'm home, I'm, with my family. I get to do the things I like to do. The travel part of it's hard. That's the hardest part about officiating. So when I do quit, that will probably be the reason why I quit.
The travel isn't the only drawback either. Being a high-profile referee means you're constantly being scrutinized by the fans, and not just those in the arena. Now there's internet chat boards where fans can sound off, and there's even a parody Twitter account someone runs anonymously called John Higgins Hair. And then there's the fans who cross the line.
I threw out a coach, and then the next day our website got hacked into at our office, and then they put all kinds of really bad stuff on there, put pictures of our kids and where they went to school and our telephone numbers. It was not very good.
All officials learn to deal with the yelling and screaming, whether it's online or on the court. Higgins says a referee has to have a thick skin, and you can't let the fans affect you.
You don't hear that one individual. You hear the whole thing, so it doesn't even... I didn't think about it anymore. In fact, sometimes you get a rush when you know you're right on plays and they're booing the heck out of you.
Did you make a good call when he was sitting on the bench in the number one position?
Yeah.
And while Higgins gets plenty of advice while he's on the court, there's also an underlying respect for the work he's doing.
Well, his poise is really good. You can see when an official gets upset. You can see when a guy's nervous or stressed, just like you can see it in a coach. And John's got tremendous poise. Quite frankly, John is one of the best officials in the country.
When I go back and think, all right, I remember arguing with him about this call, most times he's right. And, he's got a gift and he sees things well, and I think he communicates the game well to players and coaches. But at the end of the day, the great ones, they make the right call most of the time, and John's one of the best in the business in that regard.
Which is why he often earns the assignment to officiate college basketball's biggest games.
I worked at my first Final Four, and the boss said, what do you think? And I just said, I'm pinching myself from going back to when I started at third, fourth grade basketball to seventh, eighth grade girls and boys and to junior high, and I'm pinching myself. Am I really here at this place? It's kind of a dream come true.
And when the dream does end and he walks away from the game, how does this referee, whose goal is to be invisible, want to be remembered?
That I did the best I could. I worked as hard as anybody out there in the business, and I was fair. And that I am a good mentor and a good person. That's all I can ask for.
I'm Emily Henshaw. I recently retired from the United States Army 2 months ago. Don't know much about writing, but I want to write my story.
I'm a veteran of the United States Marine Corps and the mother of an Iraqi freedom veteran, and I'm here to write stories.
I was in the United States Navy. I think I have a very important story that I want to tell, and so I'm learning how to write.
I came to the first meeting and I said, okay, this feels like home. Because it is a group of veterans from all eras. We have a couple family members. We all have shared experiences. So I just felt like this is where I need to be, and I want to see this continue to grow.
Writing-wise, it's really rewarding because some of them are writing about their experiences in the military, but like all people, when you reach a certain age, you have many stories to tell.
Spend about 15 minutes in active writing. Depending on which of these activities you choose, you might want to share the new writing that comes out of it in the next 20 minutes or so.
The funny thing about writing is, you don't realize how personal it is until you start writing.
We all grew up a lot just by being in the military, but just having that common experience, not only through writing, but just everything. If you've spoken with veterans, I think when you find another veteran, you just like have this instant bond, and so it just feels very safe.
We divide into smaller groups and take turns sharing. It's kind of become a little bit of a coffee clatch in addition to writing.
We have a tendency to sort of create this facade that allows us to kind of get through the world, and we all sort of harbor vulnerabilities and stories inside that don't always get told to the outside.
I am writing a story about basically, I call it moral injury, but it's my son's story of going through Iraq and coming back and what our family went through as he transitioned back and became what we call a disabled veteran.
I started thinking about what happened with my son, visiting his friends that were killed in action. He had 11 friends that were killed over there. And just how it made me feel being a veteran myself.
This is my healing place. This is my place where I feel safe and I can let down my hair and we can laugh and cry and have fun.
What day is it today? This question infuriated me on every occasion. I lay motionless in bed, my head feeling so enormous and heavy, confused why anyone would make such an odd request.
The sort of absurdity of the question, which one, you know, obviously they're trying to, you know,
yeah,
make certain
now I know it's a
diagnostic judgments,
to ask,
right?
It
seems
mad.
So yeah. Ridiculous considering the urgency of the issue. Like, why are you asking me this question?
I should probably expand on that.
What we have here is actually peer support. This writing, because we're other military people connected, and the peer support aspect is the therapeutic part for me.
Advocating for and helping my son and those out there like him has become my passion and my life's work.
You could sort of develop in parallel your story and your son's story in a way that both brings you together.
The process of writing, whether or not the writing actually winds up being published or whether it winds up being something that other people experience, the act of writing is an act of therapy. It's often referred to as sort of like getting the toxins out or getting the poison out, sort of those things that we tend to push down.
I've tried to talk to my mom about it, but then she always wants to ask me more questions about my story than I'm ready to tell yet. And everyone here seems very supportive of the writing, and I find that when I come here and I read something, the feedback I'm getting is about the writing.
And so your anger, it just continues to go on in waves. And I get that from what you wrote.
Maybe through the writing, I'll become more comfortable with, and it will be my way of sharing the whole story with my family.
It's very healing for us to work together here and share some of these stories with each other. Whether we're blood family or not, we're all family.
Watch more Nebraska Stories on our website, Facebook, and YouTube. Nebraska Stories is funded by the Margaret and Martha Thomas Foundation